right, there I am. Wow. All right. I'm going to be doing some moving around. Might be hard to capture up there. Maybe I will sit down. Is this good? This is weird. Well, my name is Paul Tranny, work for Adobe. Here's my Twitter handle, my website as well. And next to me is Nicholas Harauz. I'm screwing that up?
It's Harauz.
Harauz. Yeah. That's much easier to say than what I tried to make it. And that's his Twitter handle as well, Clips and Handles, and his website, which I can refer to later as well. We're just really happy and excited to be here. I hope you guys are. There's a lot to cover. We both want to personally thank you guys. I mean, I know it's Friday night, and you guys made the best choice you can make for a Friday night, right? You get a drink, and you get to learn something. So it's guilt-free drinking tonight, apparently. But it's a lot of fun, and you know what? One thing that keeps us coming back here or gets us to come back is hearing from you guys. So there's a couple things going on tonight. Oh, good, I can stand. We have this hashtag. So this is where we hear from you. If you guys have questions or you like something, just do that hashtag on Twitter, and it helps us out so much. And in fact, you know what? This is shameless. I've never actually done this before. But we're going to go ahead and give away Creative Cloud for the best tweet we find tonight, okay? And it doesn't have to be positive. We're not saying, hey, kiss up to us. We're not saying that at all. We're just encouraging to hear from you guys, you know? Whether it's a good question, and if you do like something, we want to hear from you. Photo, whatever the case may be, we'll give away 1 year Creative Cloud to you guys. Thank you, exactly, because what we'll do is we'll pick it out. In the end, if you could help me with that, we'll go through the stream, and we're going to holler out a Twitter name in this room, so only the people here will win that. But hey, you know what? You don't use Twitter? That's fine. 2 other chances to actually win Creative Cloud tonight. The second one is a survey. Again, we just need to hear from you guys and find out who's in the room. Designer, developer, photographer, videographer. What version you're on, things like that. So we pull a name from there, give you Creative Cloud based on the one we pull. And then as well as the raffle. That's the easiest one. Everybody got a ticket? All right, if you did not, just, or if you want to grab a couple more, put it in that little, don't do that. So do that. But we're going to pull from there as well. So that's like 3 chances, and plus you get a ton of free knowledge, guys. I just want to show you a bunch of cool stuff, if I can, right? Things that are going to make your job easier, get things done faster, right? And just things that you couldn't do before, which is really exciting. Like this little thing is one thing I'm going to show off. Look at that. So this is, I'm going to show this later, but this is ink, okay? Which is our Creative Cloud pen, connected pen. Notice how it cycles through all the colors in the rainbow when it's fully charged. If it was dead, it just does red, and then adds color. Like little things like that. I love that stuff. And then I have Slide right here as well, our digital rulers. Put those on here. Work with them on the iPad with some new apps as well. So that's exciting. And then again, I wish I could give one of these away, but there's hardly any of these that they've even made yet. And this is like number 22. All right. So thank you so much. I do want to hear from you guys. Of course, thank you as well, those who are using Creative Cloud. 2.3 million thank yous to all Creative Cloud members, or not, either way. You're here and you're a designer, developer. I appreciate you guys. Who's on Creative Cloud just by a show of hands? All right, so about half the room. CS6, I guess you got to hold up the other hand. About 30%. CS5 or older, and it's okay. Let me just get my photo because I got to document this. No, but that's fine. That's awesome. Like, use whatever it takes to get the job done. And then I'm just going to ask a couple more questions, which are also in that survey. So that helps us gear our presentation toward people in the room, this room, if we can. Designers. So whether it's graphic design, doing print, logos, identity, that's a lot of people in the room. That's awesome. Web design. You can hold your hand up for this one as well if you're doing web design. And that's like 25, 30%. Video. Videographers, animators, that sort of thing. All right, cool. Because Nick has some awesome things to show as well. Photographers. Okay. And then last one, I'm sorry. Developers. Doing development. I don't know why you laughed at that. But all right. You know, and I think it's interesting where we're at these days, because I went to art school, I graduated with an illustration degree back when airbrush was cool, and I'm not doing airbrush these days, which I kind of wish I was, right? But things have changed, right? It's like we've had these major innovations the last decade. You know, mobile, social, cloud, as it's said, these are really the commodities. I come to expect it when I get a new iPhone. Everything through iCloud should just be on my next iPhone that I get, if I'm lucky enough to get it, right? It should just be there, and you get used to these easy ways of working. Even when it comes to mobile, I'm expecting so much to be on this little device, and this has taken the place of a lot of things, right? Like, I mean, it's one of the, am I the only one that, like, you could hardly open your eyes, and yet you're putting your phones, like, your phone is the first thing you look at? Maybe it's just me, but that's how I am. It's your nightlight, it's your clock. This thing is probably 2 time zones off, because I use my phone, right? So that's, and even when it comes to social, guys, apps, I come to expect a share button in any app that I have. So these are all commodities. It's not really that exciting anymore. Oh, you shared something on Twitter. Oh, I'm so proud of you. Nah, that's cool. I'm glad you did. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was cool a couple of years ago when you're building an app to have that share button. So it's become a commodity, but really what it means is it's all about experience these days, right? It's the design experience that you have, okay? Whatever it is, however it is designed. And there's a ton of companies that are actually led by design, okay? It's this experience design. It's your Ubers of the world and other companies. Again, I don't know all the statistics on all these companies, but a lot of these companies actually have, and hopefully I have that stat in here, because we did a survey as well, just carried on probably one of our largest surveys in general to find out what the creative community wants, and 77% say creativity and design are becoming more important to their business. So these are business owners. 70% are developing content for mobile and apps. 50% use mobile to collect inspiration and create content on the go. So it's this immediacy of getting inspired and collecting information, which really does lead us into, you know, Creative Cloud, as we'd see at this point, right? And that's where we're at, and that's what's led us to Creative Cloud, which you'll see here. Oh, that's so cool. Little choppy, that's all right. We'll work through that. But nonetheless, we knew the world was changing. We knew these devices are coming out super fast. We wanted to give you the ability to publish to the iPad, this mini, when that's available. You know, 3D printing, you know, this is new, relatively new. Like, how is this done? I have an inkjet printer at home. Can I do this 3D printing stuff? I mean, it's the design that's going to win this. This, that's going to really kind of grab hold of the future, if you will. You know, because yes, you could get excited about the 3D printer, but what are you going to print? That's going to come from designers. The creative person that put this together, for instance, this was actually all done in Photoshop, and plenty of other examples in here. Again, this is just one example of new technology that hit. You're like, hey, I'd like to take advantage of that. Hey, you know what? That's in Photoshop CC right now. There's a 3D print settings dialog in there that you could click and send whatever 3D model you found online or maybe made, and there's another company that will fulfill that order for you and send it to you, say, the following week. You know, and even something fun like this, guys. Again, just trying to get you inspired. Simple iPhone case, sure. This is just an Illustrator file, right? A designer made this. You guys can make this cool stuff. Bring it into Photoshop, print it out. A week later, you get this for $20. You have your own custom iPhone cover. To impress your friends, right? That's what I do with it. You guys like my iPhone cover? All right, so let's move on. So again, this is where we're at today. We're constantly connected. We know things are changing. We have new technologies coming out. We have new devices coming out as well. How do we deliver to them? And even when it comes to video as well, these new standards as well, like we're up to like 6K now, right?
6K footage.
6K footage.
Right in your timeline.
Yeah, yeah. And streaming from Premiere. Yeah. Like, that's amazing.
Next to 4K and 5K.
Right next to it, so in the same timeline.
The same timeline.
Same timeline, you have all three of those. Yeah. So again, like, did CS6 have that?
Nope.
Yeah, why? Because it probably
It just, there's new debugging methods these days, so you're going to see there. We've streamed some footage as best as we can here, but you'll see it actually playing right from my timeline off my laptop.
It's just crazy, and again, to have that innovation right away. All right, so we're going to run through this. We're in a connected world. I'm going to show you Typekit. We'll talk about Behance, Lightroom Everywhere. We'll dive into the apps. Not that we care what apps, the different features of them. I want to know how they're going to make me more awesome, really. And then we'll get into mobile, which is this stuff over here. In fact, what we might do is we'll do desktop apps and connectivity, and we'll get into video, and then we'll do mobile. But let's level set here, guys. Half the room raised their hand with Creative Cloud. I don't think I need to kill this at all too much or belabor all these points. But desktop apps run on your desktop. They don't run in the cloud anywhere. They're not in the browser. We're good there. You don't need to be constantly connected. Done, right? We just ping a server once a month just to make sure your membership's up to speed. Done. Okay, you could share files, and I'll do this, with anyone you want. So that PSD in the browser, send to my boss, to the client, they can look at it, comment on it, done, right? Easy enough. And they could download the PSD, okay? I'm probably going pretty fast. Let's calm down. You have control over our Windows install updates. Case in point, I have 10 updates to install. You'll see that in a second. There are enterprise solutions, even if you're inside of a firewall. So government, maybe educational institutions, you're inside a firewall. We have solutions for those cases, basically. So whether you want to be always connected or not or whatever, we got you covered. And you have more choices than just Creative Cloud full membership. We have the Creative Cloud Photography Program, which is Lightroom, Photoshop, Behance, Typekit fonts, that sort of, all those tools that you need as a photographer, and that's only 10 bucks a month. So you get Photoshop. Oh, you get Photoshop and Lightroom, 10 bucks a month. When I used to have to pay $800 a month back in college, you think I paid that much back then? Do you think I pirated? Because the camera's not on me, right? I didn't say anything. Shh. Adobe still hired me. I don't know. Weird. All right, let's move on, guys. I'm actually tired of these slides already. Can we do that? Because as I get into this, I'm like, slides. Okay, cool. Hey, performance boosts. Oh, that's nice. I want to show you all this stuff, guys. I want to show you how this is going to make you more efficient and all that good stuff. So let's exit out of this, shall we? Let's dive in, huh? During the connected section, this session is being recorded, which is great. Here I'm on the newly redesigned adobe.com. So this is going to have all this custom information for me. Okay, you see me right here. This is not my website. It's Adobe's website. They put my picture there. Go figure, right? But all in all, I can jump in, and I can see, since I'm logged in and they know I'm a Creative Cloud member, they can start serving up information specific for me. But I'm just going to go into and check out Photoshop. And I just want to show you this one thing. I want to get into, see what's new, just as an example. Going to this Photoshop page, and I can see everything that's been added to Photoshop CC, this 2014 release, just released 2 days ago. We just came from New York, where we launched all this help me, help, help, help. Like, look at it, Focus Mask and Micrograph Engine Support. This is just Photoshop, by the way. Like I mentioned, 3D printing released in January. You just hit that update, and it's in your, you know, on your machine, and then so on and so forth. But I love this page. Kind of shows the breadth of everything that we've added just to Photoshop. I mean, that's a lot of stuff. And we got a lot to do. Yeah. We got a lot to show you, don't we? So what would I do? I'd click download, right? Click download, and it installs this Creative Cloud desktop app right here, okay? And this is just a fresh install just to show you that, you know, you'll have a quick start guide, but really it'll start installing Photoshop right here. Photoshop CC. Oh, you get this 2014 release. I could still keep Photoshop CC on my machine. I could keep Photoshop CS6 still on my machine if I want to. If you want to, that's cool, right? Because we had to give you a chance to say, hey, you know what, I want this version, and here's the download asset for it. But again, up to date, blah, blah, blah. Cool, good to go. I don't need to go to the website if I don't want to. Click update if I want to update Premiere Pro. Notice right here again, if I was not here and you did not get the email or whatever the case may be, there were 10 updates and requests. So I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to hit Dreamweaver and update that, and we'll watch that progress bar since I got to demo it. It's actually already on my machine, guys. All this stuff's already updated. But that's the experience that you'll get, and you're good to go. You want to see what's new? Click what's new. All right. So let's move on. In fact, let's get into assets, okay? And I'm going to view this assets folder on the web, which is also going to be on adobe.com. All right, wait for it. Here is everything that is in my Creative Cloud account, right here. And I could easily, looks like I have a couple things going on. Let's close those. Apparently I gotta be at a, I gotta be in Toronto today. Let's close that. Good thing since I'm here. I'm glad it's not someplace else. But taking this file, I could drag it into a browser and I can upload it. That's easy enough, but I don't even wanna go to a browser because as I go back to this folder, we'll put this folder on your desktop, and from there, you can drag in whatever you want. So if I decide to bring in this Illustrator file, I drop it in that folder, and it will start to sync to Creative Cloud, and it's going to be available to me. So we'll wait for that. I did just try to upload another file. So, but any one of these that I actually want to see, okay, there it is. Right-click. Let's view on the website, we'll be able to see that Illustrator file in a browser, right? So I feel like we're gonna have this generation that's unaware of web file formats, like graphic formats, to a certain degree. Because this is an Illustrator file, we're able to render it. So we'll just wait for it. We are live streaming this, so. And I'm uploading. So here we are, Illustrator file, done. Hey, we want to take a look at this, the layers of this file as well. Jumping in here, sort of turning off that city. Okay, and it will render that out. And I have control over all of these layers. Okay? This is what I come to expect. If this was a PSD, same case, guys. You know, at this point, I can do a couple things with this particular file. I can share it with anybody I want, so I can send them a link to this Illustrator file, type in that address. Nick at awesome.com is going to get an email.
How'd you know my email?
I don't know. I just, of course that's your email. Nick at awesome.com. That's you, of course that's you. But this is the link they get. I just copied and pasted in another browser. You'll see that render out, but this is their sort of presentation view. Anybody can view this file. It's not a big deal. Guys, this has been available in Creative Cloud. Half of you guys already know about it. And again, Nick can come in here and say, oh, that's awesome, because that's what you'd say right here. So good at stuff. Or not. And you could be saying that sarcastically, sarcastic wink. I don't know. Adding that comment stays with that file. Any comments I have, thanks, you know, I'll do better next time. I want to have control over, those files and viewing them, so. All right, so look what just happened. I was pretending to be Nick, I get that comment up there, and I'll also get it in my activity stream. So I click over, go into home, here are those comments. On my desktop, so imagine this, guys, are you ready for this? I'm busy working on this Illustrator file, and then I get this comment that comes in, and he says, Paul, you're awesome, continue with this illustration. On my desktop, notification, great, thank you. I'm going to do just that, continue on this. In fact, since I'm an Illustrator, guys, why don't I just cover an Illustrator feature or two? So check this out, guys. In fact, jumping in here with this illustration, I'm just gonna add a couple things to it, and it's all synced to Creative Cloud. I'm gonna draw a couple lines, and I'm just gonna use the pencil tool. Again, the trusted pencil tool kind of coming in, and I kind of suck at this point, right? Look at that line, horrible, horrible. You could say it. I could hold down the Alt key and I can get the smooth tool and I can smooth it out, right? That's good, but I even wanna do you one better as well, right? Because I'd rather just draw awesome from the get-go. So don't even have me jump in and redo anything. And this is the rebuilt pencil tool. So as I double click, notice how we can go from accurate to awesome or smooth, right? And everything in between, click OK. Check this out, guys. I'm just going to roll over. I'm just going to draw over the top of this line. And again, it still looks kind of chunky and kind of not so good, right? Or does it, right? So you have that smoothness and you have that control, right? So that's what we want. Just make me better. Illustrator, make me a better illustrator. Right? That's what I want. Make me awesome, Illustrator. All right. How many times have I said the word awesome?
You said it, I think, three.
Three?
Well, that's kind of
like
magic. Because
I'm going for like 20, apparently. Sorry, guys. Let's move on, because what's another widely used tool in Illustrator is the pen tool. You use this all the time. Oh, pen tool, let's do this. Clicking. Because that's what I do with these lines. I'm too particular to draw with the pencil. Click once, what do I get? That anticipation of the next line. So click. Okay, where's that next line going? Oh, I know exactly where that next line is going as I start to draw out these curves, right? That's the control I want. Do you one better, guys? One better than the other, one better than, I'm doing you three better at this point. Holding down the Alt key, the path reshape, segment reshape tool. So now instead of manipulating those BZA points separately, I can just grab that line and adjust it. Say, you know what? No, I want that curve to go the other direction. I didn't have to manipulate those BZA points. So these little things that help your life out as an illustrator or designer in Illustrator. All right, let's move on. Jumping into this, in fact, I'll just kind of distract you. Hey, look up over here at this curve. Okay, good. Now let's jump back in and come down right here. Because we're taking a second look at everything. Check this out, rectangle tool. Yes, I'm gonna draw a rectangle. You guys prepared to be really excited? Oh, rectangle, stay with me. It's not just four lines connected, right? It's not just four lines connected, it's a shape. This is a live shape. So when I draw this out, oh look, it's actually aware of that it's a rectangle. So I can come in here, in fact, oh look at that little curve. We can bring that in and we can round that if we want to, right? Easy enough. I'm gonna click on it, I'm gonna hold down the Alt key again and cycle through sort of the different types that we have, okay? And if you want more control, look what panel popped up. I didn't have to hunt this down. Automatically, yes, I said automatically, the transform panel came up and I can control each one of those corners if I want to. And I could do it with my sub-selection tool as well. But, you know, again, getting whatever design I want, I have control over it. All right? So this is what we're doing. We're being intelligent about doing these simple things for you, okay? And let's just copy this. Because another thing's going on here, real simple stuff, guys. Like, let's change this. Set that. Wait for it. And let's just go there. That's a little funky. Typing 07 in. Okay. I could lock those down and change those all at once. You guys knew that would happen. I could rotate it, so when I rotate it, it's aware of its rotation. So I've just rotated it, since I rotated it negatively, it did 315 degrees. But it remembers its 0, 0 point. So if I wanna stack this back up to where its original location is, I can bring it back to 0. So it remembers where it came from. So you see its intelligence, like, hey, I know what I looked like when I was born, and I know what you did when you changed me.
That's awesome. That's,
and weird, too, that I made that metaphor. But nonetheless, that's the control you get with these tools. Let's move on. There's more I can do in Illustrator, but I need to move on. So I've cleaned this up. I saved it. I'm like, hey, Nick, I hope you like it. I made some updates to it. I didn't have to export out a JPEG and put it in an email, send it to him, and hopefully I get that email back. What happens half the time? Yeah, I didn't get that email that you sent me. Oh, you check your spam filter, and like, oh, no, it's too big. Oh, I'm going to shrink it down. No, it's here, guys. Click, view on website, and we'll see all that stuff, and it's going to be updated. You guys get it. Let's move on. I got too much to show, guys. This is what happens. Get carried away. Look, check this out. Nick and I, we've grown closer over the minutes we've known each other. But what if I want to collaborate with him? Forget just sending him a file. It's like, I want to tap into him. I want to work on a project with him. And now we have collaboration in Creative Cloud. So at this point, saying, hey, you know what, Nick? In fact, I'll do this. Dragging that file in there. Let's keep both those files. Apparently, I have two in there. But for any folder that you have, you can collaborate with somebody. They do have to be a Creative Cloud member. But if I go right-click and then collaborate, you guys see that there? Wait for it. Goes back to our connected Creative Cloud. Here it is. And nick@awesome.com was just invited to this folder, as well as Paul Gabay and me being the original owner. Okay? What if there really is a nick@awesome.com and he is a Creative Cloud member? So this is a case where you do have to be a Creative Cloud member, right? You just need to be a Creative Cloud member to be able to share a folder and mess with this stuff. I just remove that invitation, and that's good. But at that point, I can collaborate with Nick again anytime I share. You guys get the idea. All right? So that's why you get this icon. I'm sharing with two people. He could jump in there. He can manipulate that file or any one of these files, by the way. And we can work on it together, okay? And the reason I opened up this folder, let's take a look at it, because there might be a couple different copies. In fact, I left this one in here so you guys would see it. If he's working on a PSD at the same time I'm working on a PSD, and we both save within a certain amount of seconds, like which one wins, like what's going to happen with my file, you know, it will, if I save my file, it's, or if he makes a change to my file, that's going to be in the file. If we're both working on it at the same time, it's just going to give you a conflicted copy, which is what's right here. If Nick did something to this file or any one of these files, view on website. This one I know I've messed with some, so we can kind of take a look at it and roll it back. But you have versioning. So at this point, I can roll back to a previous version. Keep a copy up to 2 weeks, and you'll see it right here. So again, here's the original. Happens to be a PSD file. I want to check out the revised. Click, and I can see the revised. And what it is that text has changed from the old version to the new version, which is that text. I know, sorry, it's kind of hard to see. All right, so let's move on. I want to do some things in Photoshop now, shall we? Oh, what is this? All right, I want to do you one better, actually. Check this out. I want to show you something that often happens. Like, again, just kind of removing the clutter from everyday life, which is annoying. And one of those has to do with fonts and PSDs, you know, in InDesign, in Illustrator, right? And I'm going to do one thing for you. I'm going to show you guys Typekit. Are you guys familiar with Typekit at all? Yes? Who's familiar with it, just by a show of hands? And typically, I feel like there's like a developer group over there or something, which is awesome. Because Typekit is traditionally like a web service allowing you to use web fonts. Well, let's get into that. Fonts. I'm going to manage my fonts really fast because I have some issues with them. I'll show you what that is. Let's remove some, because I have way too many. So removed a couple fonts. That's all I did there. But check this out. Here's all my installed fonts. I have this Chaparral Pro. You know what I tried to do is I tried to install it when I already had it on my machine from another source. Typekit's not aware of my other fonts on my system. It's just aware of the Typekit fonts. But check this out. Manage fonts. You have, what, some $70,000, $80,000 library of fonts from all these different foundries that we just give to you. Say, hey, you could use these. That's what we did. In fact, here I am on Typekit, okay? Traditionally, just for web use, okay? But now you can use these fonts on your desktop. Clicking desktop, perfect. Let's look at Slab Serif. There they are. Okay? I want to use Black Oak. Sync that font that installs that font for me, right? So yes, that just happened. In fact, see, I already have that one on my desktop. You can tell that I've installed lots of fonts already. But let me jump in. Oh, I love this Sail font. This is beautiful. Sail? Let's use this one. Sail. Syncing it. Okay, the font Sail Regular was just added. And notice, you are right, because it is added. You can see it right there. Cool? Easy enough? You guys are like, Yeah, I just got this huge library of fonts. It's all right. I already had a lot of fonts. I only use 10. I do that. I have so many fonts on my machine, and I use, like, maybe 10. Am I the only one here that does that? Do you guys do that, too? You guys kind of do. You have a ton, but there's, like, my go-tos, right? I'm going to show you some things you can do there. So you have your go-tos. Nick has his go-tos. I'm going to open up this PSD. Oh, you know what? I'm not using Nick's go-to. All right. He has a font. There's a missing font dialog that comes up. So what does that mean? You got to go install that, find it, install it, and then open up that file. But we find it right away for you. Resolve fonts, done and done. I've just added that font, and now I can begin working. You guys start to see how this helps out a lot? Yeah? Yeah. Cool. Well, cheers. Cheers to that. Thanks, guys. All right, you guys just want to see pretty graphics. All right, I got pretty graphics. Okay, here's something. All right, you guys. Tough crowd. This is what I love. Simple, right? Check this out. I have this font. Inspire, create, play. That's the font I want to change. Sure, he used it. I don't like it. I want to change it. Look, as I roll over any one of these fonts, it changes. Yeah, we got a clapper. Because if you were gonna, I was gonna do this. Thank you. So again, this is you. Just do it for me. Just do this for me, right? Let's sort by just the Typekit fonts. Clicking, we could sort. I kind of like that Carry Pro font. But I also liked Sail. Sail is a little nuts. Maybe not. Oh, you know what? Since this is a headline, maybe I know I want a bold font. Type in bold, and there's my Typekit bold fonts, or just all my bold fonts right in here, right? Powerful? Easy? Because that's what I do. I jump in here, and like, I use Helvetica New. I know I'm boring like that. Hardest thing to do is remember how to spell it, right? But again, look at all these different weights. That's what I'd pick. I do New Ultra Light, because that's just sexy, right? That's what I think. Right? Again, I like having that control. That's also in Illustrator. It's also in InDesign and obviously Photoshop. Huge. All right, let's take a second look at this. This looks like I've already kind of played with this somewhat, but let's just remove some of these things. Because I have this case, guys, where I have this design, and at this point I have these circles, okay? Real common situation. Dare I say, this is like headphone worthy, almost. You put on your headphones and you just do it, right? I need to line up a bunch of circles here, okay? So I can hold down my Option key to click and drag. See those lines? So we get those smart guides. It's aware of its positioning. Oh, look, bam, 18 pixels in between. There it is. Let's drag it out some more. I get those pixels. Oh, look, that's cool. Bam. Oh, let's make sure they're all of those icons are spaced out the same amount if I want to. I'll move these in a little bit. See, that starts to make it equal to that shape beside it. There we go. We'll turn off some of these guides because I think that's the problem. Let's just drag out a couple more. In fact, let's just delete these. Dragging out one, now that you can see it a little better. Drag out another. See that they're 18 pixels apart? Drag out another. 18 pixels apart, and it's snapping. I know you guys aren't feeling that, oop, but it's actually snapping into place. So these alignment things are what we've been working on as well, right? And those are just smarter smart guides. I can hold down the shift key and I can get it relative to the entire document rather than the objects next to it, but that's what it does. So doing these like simple alignment things help out a lot, all right? Just simple production stuff. Yeah, it's not the super fancy stuff, but the stuff's gonna save your life one of these days. All right, maybe I'm exaggerating a little. Okay, so let's check this out. Let's talk about our icons, which I have had multiple icons in here. In fact, I'm gonna get rid of this one altogether because you have the ability to place linked files, okay? So you can place a linked file like an Illustrator file, like any one of these. Let's just grab this guitar, place it. And this is a linked file. Okay, shrink this into place and, you know, adjust it, get it the way I want it. Okay, so there it is. So remember, this is linked. I could double click on it and I can open it in Illustrator. That's cool, right? That's cool. It's separate. It's a separate file. You know, I can make the change that I need to make a change to. If I need to, you know, change it in any way, I can do that. I'll just leave it as is, right? Or whatever, let's change it a little bit. But overall, I can make this change to it, I can save it, and go back, all right? Seems simple enough. These are linked smart objects. You know what gets really exciting about this, guys, is that folder right here, this icon right here, that's in that folder that I have shared. So Nick could be the guy not sitting next to me, but on the other side of the world, working on the icons, right? He's working on the icons. I don't have to call him up, you know, expensive phone bill. Hey, Nick, you know what? I said give me those icons or whatever. Like, where's my stuff? I don't know. Where's the updated logo? Oh, I didn't even know there was an updated logo. Okay, they didn't keep me in the loop. Nick knew. Nick's the illustrator or the designer. I open up Photoshop, and it will tell me. And that's what that first flag was, by the way. I don't know if you noticed, but if something ever needs to be updated, all you need to do is update that content. So I can update all modified content and it will update. In fact, let's close this out. If I open it back up again, you'll see some of those situations. So come in here, let's grab the same homepage, opening that up. Hopefully I didn't save it. Again, this file has changed. I can update all modified content. And it's just updated, okay? And it will actually keep it updated for you, okay? So I basically have control. I say, hey, you know what? Update all that modified content. Technically, I only have to do that once because it just finds the path for that file. It says, okay, this is the file. And then just keeps track of it. So go, you're gonna update this guy? I'm gonna change the layout. Again, if this was in an entirely different layout, like this logo, it's in my About page, right? That one logo, I change it once. Since it links, it updates everywhere. Cool? Do you guys believe me? You guys see what I'm talking about, right? Yeah? Yeah, it's cool. Yeah, it's all right. Anyway, so again, this is fun stuff, and I could do that for you, but I think things get interesting also when you start to deal with these linked folders. So let's dive into a couple more things. In fact, I'm gonna open up this page again. Sorry, I keep on opening up the same one. Okay, let's do some fun stuff. Let's do some photography stuff. In fact, this case, for this guy, okay, he's on this one layer. Okay, here he is. I want to put that text behind his hat and his hair, right? So that's what I wanna do, because I think that would just be a cool look, right? So what would you do? You duplicate that layer, you do a little layer sandwich over here, right? So you have that top layer, and then you'd come in and you start to do that selection. And you know, this stuff would be a pain in the butt, but you try to select him and then do that mask, which I did a pretty good job there. Oh, wow. That was awesome. But again, as I start to select him, that's what you'd have to deal with. Going through, and this is where it's just a pain, guys. You guys know how this goes. When in actuality, what I could use is I could use the new focus area selection. So this focus area that I have, I can select what's in focus. So selecting focus area, I'm not touching anything, by the way, and it's already masked him out. Look at that, guys. Yeah, oh, you guys see what happened there? I did a whole lot of nothing but clap my hands. Ooh. That's what I did, because it did it for me. Oh, did it freeze? Well, there's some, no, it's, that's what I have right here. It's up there now, right? Oh, it did take a while? Oh, I'm sorry. You guys are like, what is he talking about? Anyways, but the funny thing is that went so fast, the darn projector couldn't even keep up with it. It just did it. And it did it such a good job. Look at the in-focus range. Just have it set to auto. And I'll keep an eye on that screen. Sorry about that. But if I want to have more or less, it's just a matter of adjusting the slider. So if I want to start to grab that guy behind him, I could grab him, grab her, different parts of the scene, maybe tighten it up. I have that sort of control, okay? So this is fun. It's doing that focus area selection. Okay, so that's what I do here. I can do that. I can select auto. I can jump in and refine that edge as well. This is a tool we've had. But coming in here for this one. Wait for it. There we are. Selecting the hair. Okay, and you can see what it did there. I'm just able to select more of his hair. I can do some other things in here, but again, refine mask. Has it the way I want it, and that looks pretty good at this point. I can, you know, move that around and adjust it any way I want. But the fact that I didn't have to go in there, sorry, it's going a little slow. I'm like 2 minutes ahead of you guys, apparently. I'm gonna be done earlier tonight. I'm like, see ya, done, as the stream. No. All right, cool. And I could probably look down there. I don't know if that's keeping up. Is that one? I don't know.
It's lagging.
Okay. No. So again, that's awesome. It did this for me. It does the mask. That's good to go. I can further adjust. You guys get the idea. Focus area selection will do any sort of focus that you want. Let's do some more photography stuff. There's actually lots of things I want to do. There's too many things that are going through my brain right now. But let's do this, guys. Staying within the context of a web page, right? And I can turn on all these layers. Okay. Here's all the layers. And what I can do in Photoshop is I can take any layer, like you see right down here, say, take this electronic layer. You'll see it in a second. Wait for it. Wait for it. You guys see it? Wait for it. Now you guys said, awesome. I can take any layer in Photoshop. And what I need to do now is my design is done, and I need to start kicking out all of these different little graphics as just single graphics, right? Because they're going to be used on a web page or whatever. Typically, it would be a web page. This file in particular, I can make this a ping file by just typing in ping. All right? That's what I'm doing here, typing in ping. You guys are going to see it here in a second. Wait for it. I am faster than that. But that's all I have to do is just rename those layers. Ping, JPEG, GIF, right? I could even do SVG. Oh, let's do you one better right up here. Taking all of these layers and grouping in them into one folder. And I'm going to call this folder frontman.jpg. Okay, so I've named an entire folder frontman.jpg. Wait for it. Wait for it. And there it is. So now all I have to do in this folder, okay, get rid of that one because that one has a very long name, and go to File, Generate, Image Assets. Selecting that, anything that has a suffix, it kicks out as an image, is what it just did. I'm zooming in on that. Right? Wait for it. Wait for it. It's coming. I'm too fast for the computer. Is it update yet? But either way, those are the images that it kicks out. So all you have to do, name your layers, go to File, Generate Image Assets. It'll kick out all those layers, anything you want. This is huge, because what do you not have to do? You don't have to jump in there and get your darn X-Acto knife, it's so old school, and slice things up. Or copy this and put it in a new file and then save out a JPEG or PNG file from there. Because that's what you'd have to do in previous versions. Or turn off all the other layers except for that one and then export it out. You just name it. Hey guys, you know what? I want to change this front man. Maybe I want to change the font. Let's jump in there. Or maybe I want to flip. Here we go. Let's change the font, for instance. Changing the font, and I'm not touching anything, and it changes the font, right? So there's that live connection between Photoshop and my image assets. Bunch of little gremlins working away, and that's a live connection. Cool? Makes sense? Yeah? Yes. Can anybody see how that could help their day-to-day job? Yeah? All right. Don't be lying to me. All right, let's move on because I have some more things to show you. All right, since we're having a problem with some of the motion here and speed, let's talk about that. Adding motion where there really isn't any, okay? In this case, guys, check this out. Here's Jesse Boykins, man. He's happening. Cool guy, still frame, right? And this whole picture needs more motion than it actually has, right? I want it to be more dynamic. So at this point, for that layer, what I want to introduce you to is the blur gallery. So let me zoom in on that. You guys see it in a sec. Okay, got it. So what this is, what we have available to us now are path blur and spin blur. So check this out, I could add path blur to Jesse. So look at that. Already, as it launches into path blur, we'll see it here in a second. Wait for it. It just really wants you to realize the impact of those options there, apparently. But check this out, path blur. If I decide I want to have motion of his hand going from one point to another, I'm just drawing a line, okay? So I just drew a line. Let's go to his hair. Having his hair going from point A to point B, right? But he's not doing the robot. He's smoother than that, right? So let's just curve that out. It's basically a BZA point, and it will actually curve out that direction, okay? So I can draw those lines, and you get that motion that direction. Okay, you see what's going on there? I now can make this like much more dynamic. I can start to control the speed, okay? Control the speed of the entire frame at this point, and you can see how blurry that gets. I could do something called a rear sync flash, which will actually just make it look like it'll give you the blur sort of after the image, and there should be like a hard edge on one side. But at that point, I've just added path blur, click OK, and there you have it. Again, just adding motion in life, just real quick, to Jesse in this case, right? So again, that's the control I want. I actually like that version. Giving him some motion, you can get a lot more fun with it as well. Here's just another image that I'm opening up. You can see him right here, and you have that sort of swooping motion. You can, again, this is a tool that was not available to you in previous versions. A lot of times, guys, what this is used for is in the automotive industry. Okay, so you can use it for anything, but I'm going to drag this file in here. I'm going to open it up and show you a thing or two. But there's basically an application that's like a couple thousand dollars that, go away dialogue. Man.
Busted.
Darn it. So that's, Wait for it. This is a big file too, guys. I'm gonna show you what's going on here. But you'll see what's going on. I'm gonna click to the final version. Spin blur is pretty obvious. Like if I had anything obviously doing a spin, I can add that motion to it. And it could be any shape we want. So let me just go to that particular file. So wait for it, wait for it, wait for it. Going back in here. Let's take a look at this scene going forward. Adding this is actually, that's fun. Yeah, there's an elephant there. All right, you think I would have fixed this file, but you know what, why not? Why not have an elephant in there? So check this out. This is just a vehicle, and that's what's done with this background scene. See that motion there is done with the path blur. And all that's added is just that spin, that path on that background. As for the wheels, if we take a look, that has the spin blur, as we can see here in a second. Wait for it. Wait for it. Wait for it. Hold on. Hold on. I know I have a lot of things running as well. Probably have music still playing. Let's put out an Illustrator. But let me just show you the final version again right here. If I could just turn that on, you will see the, you should see the wheels. All right, so we will, I'm going to get that taken care of as well. I started syncing lots of files, so I will take care of that here in a second. So, all right, cool. All right, so let's take a look here. So what that was, guys, is that was actually a 3D model. I added spin blur to the wheels, okay? So you essentially get what you see here. You get this sort of look where a spin blur has been added to the wheels, you have path blur on the sides, okay? Even for this car, guys, so we did the survey, polled a ton of creatives, and an area that designers think is going to be crucial to their success in the future, at least within the next 12 months, is 3D, right? And that's something I'd like to show you, but it's important even in this case. In the case of Audi, they have the 3D models long before they actually have the physical car. So you can't even do any advertising until they actually build the car. Is that how that works? No, it's a 3D model. Right here, this 3D model. Most products you see out there today, they do the packaging for it. The virtual product exists long before the actual project does, or product does. In fact, even when it comes to pitches, do you want to go in with a sketch or a storyboard, or would you like to go in with something that looks more realistic just to win that job, right? And that's sort of some of the benefits to 3D in this case. So I'm gonna move on. In fact, we might throw it a video because I had to clear up my startup disk. Can I do that? I think I'm gonna do that. Does that sound good? So there's a couple things I need to show. I'm gonna dive into some 3D, show you some 3D printing. I wanna cover Muse, as you saw, as well. Then I also need to cover devices. But I'm gonna throw to Nick. Actually,
Hi, I'm Nick. I'm gonna show you guys some new features in Premiere Pro and After Effects and sort of the future of video. And I can say, since using Creative Cloud, when it first came out, there's been hundreds and hundreds of updates that have already been done to Premiere Pro. And some of the things they've brought into this version is just, well, let's just call it a little bit of magic, where they're taking some tasks that are done primarily, let's say that you had a workflow between an editor and a motion graphic artist. Some of those mundane tasks that you tell them to go back, like switching text, is now easy and updatable directly in Premiere. So the first thing I'll bring your attention to is my timeline here, and what we're looking at is a piece of video on the bottom and a text template, and this file actually comes from After Effects. Now, in the past, if there was, let's say, a spelling mistake or anything like that, you would have to go over to After Effects, really go in, edit the original. But on this version, what you're able to do is edit the text template directly in Premiere. So how I do that is I'm gonna load the After Effects file directly into the source monitor. You can see that loads up here. And this clip has a bunch of effect controls. You see the text here. Just gonna put in your name there, Paul. You can be a skier for a little while.
Sweet.
How's my?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
We see that going on. And you can see here, once I hit the tab key, it updates right away. can just avoid that whole process of having to round trip over to After Effects. And I think just in terms of spelling mistakes or anything like that, you can easily handle that by the video editor. Crazy cool feature. Looking at another example here, I have a bunch of different text available right here on the timeline. I'm just gonna add a third piece of text, and what I wanna do is just switch the lettering. So I can go inside, I'm actually gonna just control click a clip here and reveal it in my project so I don't have to go looking for it very far. I'll load it into the source monitor and edit it really quickly onto my timeline using some keyboard shortcuts. So what I wanted to do is if I make a change to any of these templates, the name is gonna ripple through. But if I wanna have a completely independent title, what I could do is just simply duplicate that title in the project panel, right? And it's still connecting to the After Effects source. So I will take this clip, go to my edit menu, duplicate it, bring it into the source monitor, and through a little magic, just simply get that into the timeline. Connect back to that clip, and instead, maybe call this something else. Let's adjust that template name under the effect controls. There we go. And those changes update right away. Right? So simple text changes made easy directly in Premiere Pro. Now, how many of you have had a situation, let's say, how many of you guys are video editors or motion graphic designers, and your producer has come out there and said, you know what, I really need you to blur out this person's face, okay? And what you'd have to do is go to, essentially, the motion graphic designer, and you'd have to track it back in After Effects. Well, now, in Premiere Pro, rather than rotoscoping or anything like that, it's made easy. There's a built-in tracker. So it's built into many of the effects. What I'm gonna do here in my effects panels on the lower left-hand corner, I'm gonna do a search. I'm gonna do a search for a mosaic effect. Okay. Found it. I'm gonna drag it, drop it onto my clip, and all of a sudden, of course, my screen becomes filled with this mosaic. But you'll see these little two buttons just at the side on top of the effect, and this is your ability to create a mask. So I'm gonna create a mask directly on my clip. I'm gonna move to the first frame. I'm gonna start to size this mask and move it right there over my subject. So you see that mask? Now, I'm gonna go back to this effect, and look there, I have tracking options. So right now, I'm just gonna choose to track this mask forward. Now, is it updating on the screen there? Just give it 1 second. It's gonna update in hopefully 1 sec. Hold on, I'll just do a little quick. Now let's hop over to your screen for a sec.
Okay. All right. So thank you for bearing with us, guys. Again, hardware needs to kind of catch up with the software at this point. So we'll just switch to me really fast, because again, I have more to talk about that I did not get to either. So let's just switch to this screen if we could. Thank you very much. All right, cool. And again, this is where I left off. I was showing you that car. I talked about that vehicle. I'm going to even take it a step back, all right, because I don't work for Audi. I would love to get that job by importing a 3D model, which you can do. You're interested in, you know, having access to 3D? Hey, look, within Photoshop, get more content. That's getting more 3D content. And thanks to 3D printing, and just the need for 3D, there's a lot more, there's just a ton of content available out there. All this links out to free assets. But I'm gonna keep this super simple, because check this out, for this logo, taking a simple shape layer, take anything I want in here, and all I need to do is open up my 3D panel, and create an extrusion from that shape layer. All right? Also just be a photo as well. But I've extruded it now. You can take a look. And as I rotate it around, you guys can see that that's 3D, and I have full control over it, right? So I'm just rotating it around, and you can see, again, some of the lines and perspective there. But let's take a look at this, because I'm looking at this, and I'm starting to think that rather than putting a logo on a cup, I want to turn this logo into an actual cup. So let's rotate it so it's facing up. Straight 90 degrees. Let's taper it, this extrusion, let's taper it about 70%. What about that top edge? Well, we can adjust that contour. Okay, I just made it really sharp there, right? Well, we can smooth that out as well. So I made it nice and smooth, okay? You'd see it's gray on the sides. I can change that texture as I'm doing right now, changing it to a ceramic, okay? So I'm already 90% there, right? What did I do? I just extruded, tapered, adjusted the bevel. Obviously, I don't know how coffee cups work, right? Or it's a dribble cup, one or the other. But check this out, guys. Look, edit source. I don't have to worry about messing with a mesh, any 3D. Jumping in here, lovely 2D environment, using those tools I'm comfortable with. Jumping in here and just modifying this any way I want. Okay, so I have full control and editability as I dive into this. So I can seal up those parts, you know, make them one layer. So that's a smart object, but I'm going to close that file. When I go back, you can see I've seamed it up, okay? There's still a little bit of a line there that you guys are not seeing, so never mind. There's not a line right there. But if there was, I could patch that up, because it's all about editing source, okay? I could then add a bottom there, guys, right? Because there's no bottom, okay? I don't know if anybody caught that. But this is the fun part, taking that whole scene, and right here, check this out. 3D print settings, okay? So right over here, within Photoshop, you could print in 3D. If you're lucky enough to have a 3D printer, you could select that 3D printer, or check this out. Changing this to Shapeways, okay? This is just an online service provider. Just seeing how it looks up there. And check this out, guys. These guys will do the fulfillment for you. And it has everything from, you know, gold to, you know, brass to bronze. They got silver, they got ceramic, plastic, sandstone, steel, colored, full-colored sandstone. Here's the glaze, you know, ceramic, glazed ceramic. I can click print, and I can print that out. This is actually going to be kind of large because I've scaled it up. So we'll see here in a second. But it does all this magic that you don't even need to worry about, okay? I told you, just so you know, I made it really big so it fill. This is really huge. Well, let's not worry about the price. Because it would not be $500, okay? It wouldn't. It's more like the Creative Cloud bathtub at this point, okay? But overall, this actually worked out really well. Because notice it gives me this original mesh is in green. If any walls needed to be thickened, so if there were thin parts that just were really thin, saying, hey, you know, I can't, it's like, hey, I'm ceramic, I can only get so thin. So what Photoshop will do is it'll thicken that part of that wall so it's a successful print. Okay, any holes that need to be closed, like a little, any issue like that, it takes care of it. Because you know what? It's aware of the material, it's aware of the printer, because the ceramic printer isn't the same thing as the metal printer or the plastic printer. Okay, so, and it's aware of all of those issues. And you know what? If I had my own MakerBot 3D printer, that's a whole nother set of issues that you don't need to worry about, because Photoshop will take care of that stuff for you, okay? And I can even show you how that works. But again, that's what I did. I hit export. Basically, it'll take me out to Shapeways, and, you know, again, I just kind of give them my information. But at this point, this is actually, again, printed ceramic cup printed from Photoshop. Okay? Pretty cool, right? Cheers to that. I should put some beer in it. Cool. So again, that's the idea. You know, again, like I said earlier, this, all the cool stuff's going to come from creatives and designers. So there's a plethora of things up here. Even if you take something simple like this, again, this case, which was done in Illustrator. So I downloaded the frame of the iPhone, right? And then I've just extruded my illustration and put it right on top and printed it. And I have this template. In fact, on my website, I show you guys how to make this. And I give you the PSD, so all you need to do is modify that Illustrator file.
That's cool.
Right? So that's really impressive what you could do there. So, yeah, we're going to see how that we work about that situation with you. But again, that was really powerful. You guys saw that. Very cool. Available to you. That's in Photoshop. I'm sure there's other things I need to take a look at. Let me show you just a couple. Let me just click through some quick things. Sure, yeah. Is that all right? Oh, shoot. Not right here. I'm going to get a little bit into a web design, all right? And there's a couple different ways to do that. In fact, we have a couple different apps, okay? We have Dreamweaver, right? Which is what I'm in now. And we also have Muse, okay? So let's take a look. Let's just real fast, just for the developers in the audience or anybody doing web design, I'm opening up this file right here. Okay, and we saw this earlier. I exported out all these graphics, right? And sort of the goal, actually, what your life consists of as a designer or developer is working in code view and then previewing in a browser and then going back to your code view and previewing in a browser, because that's what you do, right? And that's your life, right? Well, in Dreamweaver, as I click this live view button, this is a browser running in Dreamweaver, okay? This is Chromium embedded framework. This is what Safari and Chrome are based off of, right? And it's actually, this is basically, in fact, this URL right up here, I could type in google.com and it will pull in Google, right? Okay, and that's what happens. You do that dance, but now you don't have to do the dance of going, checking in a browser, coming back, changing the code, because that's what you notice. As I take a look right down here, say for instance, I want to change something, I can jump in and, again, at this point, change any text that I want to change, right? So I can add text right in here from live view, so you're basically editing in a browser. I want to change this image, change that image. Not a big deal, guys, all right? Using that image of Jesse at that point, okay? So just swap that out, because you don't know what image that is typically till you preview it in a browser. You're like, oh, that's the wrong one. Right, and you have full control. If I wanted to add any classes to that, I'm not sure which class I would add. Ooh, artist. I'm not sure which one would change it. I'll have to take a look. But overall, I have full control. I have this properties inspector. I can get that information and work with it that way. Let's take a look. The last thing I'll show in Dreamweaver real fast, as I select inspect mode, let's hit F4 and show you the CSS designer panel. So check this out. I'm rolling over this content. Okay, I'm going to start to take a look at some of this content, and hopefully that is updating. But again, I'm in inspect mode. I have my CSS designer panel open. So as I roll over things, I see the CSS change on the right side. Okay, so again, this is basically your CSS inspector, all right, at this point. I could do a reverse of that, because look, as I select, say, for instance, any one of these CSS classes, any of these rules over here, it highlights on the page where that's being applied. Okay, so I can see where's this hover being applied, or any link, where's that being applied, and I can start to select that content. Okay, going even into any one of these, in fact, I could show the set properties, which is what I want to do for this little button really fast. Again, clicking here, I can take a look at that. This is my EPUB. There's my hovers and all of those various properties. In fact, I don't even have to worry about clicking through different rules because I could just click on computed. I could care less where that CSS is. Hey, change the color, you change the color. Forget what CSS page that's on, I can do that, right? So that's Dreamweaver for you. Gives you those properties, everything you need, lets you know that, hey, you know what, you're not scared of code view. Hey, it's fine, I have access to that It's awesome. Quitting out of that, and then just jumping into Muse really fast. So again, you mentioned I mentioned code, and I lost you guys, maybe, right? Who's using Muse in the room by a show of hands? Which is great, guys. This is awesome, all right? Easy enough. I'm starting from scratch. First of all, look, it's dark gray. We really rebuilt it from the ground up. It was an Adobe Air app. We rebuilt it. It's a native app running extremely well, right? I want to jump in here. I want to add a page. You guys get the idea. Bam, bam, gallery. Adding that. Contact. Bam, done. Oh, we can move this contact page right next to the home page, right? I have full control over all these pages. This is easy. This is like InDesign. Oh, look, right down here, master page. Let's double click on that master page. You know, let's add, you know, a bar at the top. Yeah. All right. So again, I can add whatever I want using these tools. It's pretty simple, guys. Like, this is where you could start to have some fun. And you can start to import assets as well. So I can import and even, look, place a Photoshop button if I want to. Did you notice how I just selected the word place? Because the InDesign team built Muse. So if you're using InDesign, this is for you, okay? And again, it's just a matter of locating, you know, that logo or that graphic, wherever it is. So let's just try to find it. You know, there's a play logo, sure, why not? Bam, there it is, done and done. Okay, so check this out, guys. Going into the widgets library, because you know what? We need to add functionality. Well, let's add a menu, which by just dragging out the horizontal, you'll see it here in a second, a horizontal menu, okay? I don't know if you guys can see that. Actually, I'll zoom in on it. And that's, again, magic, right? Because look, I didn't type in artist gallery contacts. I didn't type that in. Do you think those buttons work? They do. They definitely work, right? They better. Whether I'm horrible at presenting it, this information. No. Wouldn't that be cool, though? All right, so let's move on. Because you'd want to do more in here as well. So I would click into the gallery page, you know, and I could have a gallery. Again, what do you expect? Slideshows. Oh, here's a gallery. So I can drop in just a, you know, blank gallery. You want to load in images? Hey, guys, it's simple. Point to some images, just like that, open, and there's your images, okay? You can start to resize this any way I want, but I have more controls in here as well. So if I want this to go full screen, I can select full screen. Now, I also want to move it back. So anyways, that's what I'd want to do as well. So let's not worry about that, because I also have these other buttons here, and it's all a matter of having full control over that and just using this pop-out menu. It shows me the preview next. Hey, I don't have captions. We can turn that off as well. I can turn off most of those buttons, but look, I can enable swipe, and I should actually be able to navigate it with my arrow keys if I decided to not have these buttons here. But in general, I've just added a gallery, and that's what you get. Even in the case of this website, this is the final version, and maybe you want to see this play. Let's do that, because I'm kind of cheating. All right, so I've been in plan view. I went into design view. I can click preview it on the desktop. Okay, and see, obviously, not much going on here. Gallery page, that's where I added the gallery. I did not move those buttons. Very embarrassing for me, right? I had autoplay turned on, so it was actually rotating through automatically, right? This is fun, guys, and this is the first thing I would do is say, you know what, I'm making a portfolio, and I'm gonna post it. That's what I would do. It's like, finally, I get to design whatever the heck I want. I don't wanna see CSS, I'm not gonna see CSS, right? And that's what I do, but that's the power of it. Sort of, you know, bringing you to this case where you can see in preview this fully baked version. There's some fun things going on here. Because what do I love on the web, and what's hot right now is, first of all, there's a fun animation, right? Done in Edge Animate, cool. But there's also scroll effects. So as I scroll down with my mouse, okay, and I'm gonna grab off to the side here, You could see everything start to break up as I scroll. And that's the scroll effects that I have integrated. And as I scroll down, all that content slides off, and I can get to this information if I want to. So you have things like scroll effects, which is really popular right now, okay? And you have the ability to add any sort of functionality that you want. In fact, I've just clicked through to this NinjaSonic page, and you have control over this layout. And, you know, the next thing you'll ask is, you know, video or audio. You can see there's a video right here. Is this YouTube video? Just dropped it in, right? Audio's the same way. Look, what does this say over here? Twitter links. So those social media links are all baked in through that same widgets library, okay? So I've used it to add a gallery, then I use it to add social media, audio, video. There's hardly something that can't be done in Muse, and I'm being serious when I say that, okay? And we can take a look at it. Again, it's all right in here. In fact, again, that's where they are. Even going beyond that, there's a couple things I need to talk about. You're like, well, what if, oh, I wrote this special HTML something or other. Okay, fine, this is your get out of jail free card, because this is your insert HTML. Paste in any HTML you want. You have some special tracking code that corporate gave you, you paste it in right there and you're good to go. And that's how it works. Going beyond that, I'm gonna talk about two more things and then we could try yours again. We'll see how it does, huh?
Yeah, I think it's better now.
Oh, good, good, good. Oh, yeah, great, yeah, to hear. Okay, so, awesome, well, thank you. Let me shut up then. Tablet, I can take that same layout, that desktop layout, and make a tablet layout. And I can take that same layout and I can make a phone layout. So I have that ability. Here it is, that same website formatted for the phone. So I'm covered when it comes to devices as well. Okay, and it gives me this new layout and I have full control over that, because what I have on the desktop might not be the same what I want on my mobile phone. So that's Muse, totally rebuilt with the big boys, right? Just like Photoshop, Illustrator, and Dreamweaver, all that. And this is the last thing I was gonna do is talk about two things, but I'll show you. I can click the publish button, okay? And I can upload it to a business catalyst site. So basically, with Creative Cloud, I have hosting for 5 sites is what I have. So at this point, I just enter in a temporary URL, you know, and upload to Playfest Paul is what I do. It's gonna upload to playfestpaul.businesscatalyst.com. That URL doesn't matter, it's just my testing URL. I'm gonna show you the admin area. The admin area actually gives me the ability to add my own domain name if I want. So let's jump out to a browser. Let's take a look. This is awesome, guys. You have 5 sites, hey, use them. Hey, you already have that contract with GoDaddy, right? You can export out your site as HTML. Okay, so that's what that says there. Export as HTML, or upload to an FTP host. So we're saying, hey, you don't want to use us? That's fine, use whoever you want. You have full, this is your site, you do whatever the heck you want with it, right? So that's what we're giving you. And this is the fun part, because even if I use my site, hold on, don't look, FTP, this could be any FTP login, actually, just so you know. This could be anywhere, but I can go right in here. Again, you guys are not seeing this, are you? They're like, Paul, thanks, Paul. We have to now change. okay, here we are in desktop view. But at this point, I've logged in. And that's what you do. I give my client the login information, and they can jump in. You know what? This wild leaves, they're called wild left, or whatever. they disbanded. Right? It doesn't matter, but I can click update, and that will update. It puts the power in their hands if they want it. Just like that, update done. Cool? Was that easy or was that easy? Only two answers you get. Powerful. Awesome. You turn around, you charge your client you charge them $50 a month for hosting and editing and stuff. I'm not telling you what to do, but you know, you have Creative Cloud covered at that point, right? So that's what I wanted to show you with Muse, and we'll turn over to video stuff now as well, and hopefully we have a chance to get to devices, which is a lot of fun. So thank you for joining me on the segment. Yeah, you can clap. Cheers.
All right. So I'm just seeing here my interactivity. So just where I left off, which you didn't see, which I was so excited about, was this lovely little mask that I've placed around the, just taking a second to update.
Come on, baby.
Come on.
Come on. Here, let me.
Oh, there we go. Okay. So this lovely mask that I put around a subject's face, right? And this was done right in Premiere. It was on the effect. I clicked this ellipse tool, placed it on her face. So I'm gonna move over here to the side really slowly. I wanna be delicate because I want this to work.
Okay.
Right, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just click this button, which is track the selected mask forward. Notice, how it's actually
hiding
her identity, following her, going frame by frame, and my tracking job is done within literally 2 minutes. So this is built inside Premiere. No function like this in terms of tracking was ever inside Premiere. They brought some of that functionality from After Effects into here so that easy problems that solve that happen every single day can be easily solved by the video editor. But what if, let's just say, there are some cases where there's more challenging problems. So we can see here that this subject himself, there's many problems, but we see here that the subject himself is kind of going by this little sign. And what we want to do, or our intention, is to blur out this sign in particular. So I'm going to send this particular job to After Effects, because how After Effects has changed is that masks can now have effects. So I could, first of all, in Premiere, do my little tracking. You can see here that this sign is blurred out. Just like before, it's a mask. In this case, it's a fast blur effect that has the mask on it, and I can click on this tracking button, same as before. It's done in real time. The problem is when this subject's head comes in the way of the actual sign, it's gonna be all blurry. So I wanna go into After Effects there for a second, add a actual ellipse mask around his head and then track it as well and subtract it from this. Okay, so tracking's done. It sticked with the sign even though that subject's head came in the way. That's awesome. So I'm gonna basically take this clip and quick way to send this over to After Effects is to hit Command E, or I'll just edit the original file. And we'll see here in a second After Effects will open up. Okay. Actually, sorry, I have to actually send this to, my apologies. This file is not an After Effects file. So I'm gonna go into here, into the file menu, and I'm gonna Adobe Dynamic Link and replace this with an After Effects composition. This is how the linking happens between After Effects and so. And more importantly, just notice that all that work that I did in Premiere has been saved over here. So I'm gonna come in and really quickly come up to one of my tools over here. Okay, my ellipse tool. And I'm gonna just draw this mask over the subject's head. So I could do this in a couple different ways. I could draw from the center, hold down, drag out, use my space bar to kind of get this nice and right. And there's my mask over the subject on the first frame of this. And just to see this better, I'm gonna change the mask's blend mode to none, just so I see this clearly, right? And I think this is gonna kind of fall off a little bit, or at least that's what I'm gonna predict. So I have the option here with the tracker in the lower right-hand corner to go frame by frame. So literally I can start here this track frame by frame. I'll kind of move to the area where it really gets problematic. Move this mask on over. Oopsies. Okay. So this is where all that action starts to happen. Get that mask nice and right. And really quickly go frame by frame. And if there's any problems that happen during this, I could easily just offset it. And even so, this still does a pretty good job setting me up. Can adjust this in real time, just making sure I pick the right mask, of course. Following the subject. Oh, so that's where it kind of fell off. Okay, so just here with this track, the real magic comes on this lower side where what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hit the Shift E key to bring up my After Effects, all of my effects. And there's the fast blur that I brought in from Premiere. So I'm gonna click this button down here in the lower corner called Compositing Options. And you can see that I have my mask 1 and also my mask 2 for reference. With this mask 2 now for reference under the compositing options, which I just added, I'll apply that subtract blend mode. And you can see that it's minus from the mask. So masks now have these effects which a lot of After Effects users have asked for, but all of our tracking problems in terms of motion tracking in these applications has come that much easier across the board, saving us tons of times in the video production process. Really, truly exciting. So I'm gonna hop back over into Mirror and just show a couple other things. And one of these things is the idea of something called master clips. So the effect process in Premiere involved taking an effect and placing on a clip. And if we wanted that same click to have the same look over the entire duration of the project, what we would have to do is essentially paste that effect over and over again. Well, now we have the option to, I can call up this clip. This is a clip in the timeline or a segment. And if I hit the F key to perform something called the match frame, I load it into the source monitor. And in the source monitor, what I'm gonna do now is just throw a color look effect onto it. So I'm gonna go down here into my video effects. I'm gonna find a brightness effect. Lovely. I'm gonna hit that tilde key. Type in brightness and contrast. There I've got my effect, okay? I grab that and apply it to my clip in the source monitor. And in the source monitor, I'm gonna drag up the brightness. We can see that that updates in the timeline, but even more excitingly, because this is a clip that came from the project panel, all three options of it switch, saving us tons of time rather than having to copy and paste effects over and over again, right? So all three copies of this clip were now affected as this was a master clip here in my timeline. Really streamlined workflow in dealing with Premiere. Now, the next thing, just talking about master clips and making workflows faster. While I would love to show you that this next timeline over here is actually consists of 4K, 5K, 1920 by 1080 footage. And on my laptop, it wouldn't show so well there on the screen, I could play this back in fairly real time. Right? I'm able to see that, and I'm able to mix and match these formats. And on top of that, they're in their native format. So one of these clips, I'll actually just show you. I wanted to show this real-time playback, but we could actually select it, or right-click it, and I would reveal it in here, and we would see that it was actually basically a 4K red file, which I also have the options of adjusting in terms of its raw format. But on top of that, when we start talking about 4K, 5K, or even 1920 by 1080, sometimes we want to do color correction. And while Premiere has a lot of color correction options, the best place to go is SpeedGrade. And up until now, the workflow between SpeedGrade and Premiere has been okay, but now it's much easier. So I can take my actual sequence, and from the file menu, see here if I get an update, I can do a direct link to Adobe SpeedGrade. SpeedGrade. So let's just see what happens. We'll see, it asked me to save the changes in my Premiere Pro CC project and open up this timeline in SpeedGrade. So I'll click yes. SpeedGrade opens up. It's doing a little bit of post-processing, but what I have here is a completely new interface. You can see that I can drag my playhead current time indicator across all of these clips. Now, I have a couple different options. One is I can easily come down here to look at a bunch of different looks, and now SpeedGrade has a ton of different looks available for you in terms of LUTs that are available both in Premiere and both in here. And I can select one of these looks, right? And simply through a double click, apply it to a clip. But just like Premiere, where I have multiple versions of a clip, I have the option of applying it to just the clip alone or to the master clip. And if it's applied to the master clip, it's going to streamline down to all of those three clips, saving me time in color correction. So I'm just going to come here, choose one of these looks by double clicking, and see that it's applied not only to this version because I applied it on the master clip, but all the other versions subsequent. So it's a pretty cool process in terms of just being able to make these changes and see that they update right away. And even better, when I'm finished my color grading process in Premiere, I can simply click this button and it's going to send me back there with all my color correction changes done. So really what to take away from it here is the workflow processes across the applications in the video applications are that much quicker for us to get our work done. We can simply go over to SpeedGrade, make a change to a master clip, and then go right back into Premiere and continue with our workflow. That's pretty cool. And there's also some small things here that you can see on Adobe's website, such as I have now the ability to autosave a project to the cloud. So as a video editor, just a side note, this is a personal love of mine, is that not only am I saving constant versioning products on my desktop, but on the cloud, I can set it up under my preferences to autosave Premiere projects. So just in case my office burns down, my cat comes onto my computer and throws water, which has happened during some productions I've worked on, I have that backup in the cloud that I can always go to, and my media and my footage is always protected. So that's some cool, pretty cool features that are new within Premiere Pro. I just want to take a look at a couple more of the apps, one of those being Prelude. And out of curiosity, how many people have touched or gone into Prelude to do any type of logging, make notes, and so forth? There's a couple new features in here that are definitely worth mentioning. And one of them is the ability to now tag clips very easily. So I'm right now inside Prelude. I'm going to go to the window menu, and you'll see that there's an option to bring up a tagging panel. And what I need to do is just simply set up a tag, because this is the first time I've done it. So I'm going to click on this plus icon, and I'm going to call this tag really simply accept, reject, and I'm going to save that tag. Now, I have the option of now creating these buttons to easily tag my clips directly here when I load up a clip. So I'm going to just really quickly change this into, rather than have 6 rows and 5 columns, make this 1 and 2. Great. I'm going to take this first tag, I'm going to keep it. I can colorize it if I want, and I'm going to give this tag the first name, accept. I'm going to select or click this second tag, really quickly type in. I'm going to change the color now, something else rather than that green, maybe a blue, and probably red would be better for reject. I'm used to that red color all across, but I'll just call that reject. And you can also set up a duration for each of these tags. So right now, I just want to show you that the duration for these tags are approximately 60 frames. And it's easier for me to find or spot on a clip accepted sections or rejected sections, let's say by a producer, before I bring this content into Premiere Pro. Right, so I'm just going to load up a clip to show this. Right, so I have my tag set up. I'll just hit OK. I've got those tags showing up here. I'm going to just find one of these clips called Helicopter. And show it here in my timeline. I'm going to scrub across the footage. Maybe I'm playing it in real time. Are we able to see that? No. So I'll just pause there for a second. And I'm just going to click this button, call this accept. Reject. Accept. And I just want to show you that these tags are getting added to that clip as notes with the various times that I've set them to. Okay? Another thing that's new with Prelude is, first of all, I have the button, the option here in the project panel to only show the subclips that I've made. So these are the in and out decisions that, let's say, a producer has come around and made. And I just want to take a collection of these clips, okay, and I want to build a rough cut out of it. So I'm just going to grab four of these clips, let's say five. And with these clips selected, I'm going to go down to this little button down here, which is to create a rough cut. Just trying to see if this is updating. Do that again. Right, so it asked me to create this rough cut. I'm just going to call this ski footage. I'll save it. And my timeline already opens up with all of these clips ready to go, laid out exactly how I had it in the project panel. Now look how easy it is for me. I could play back this material, get a sense for these shots, and if I didn't like the order they were in, I could just simply grab one of these clips, drag it to a new location. And it just switches those directly there in the timeline. Even better, I now have the ability to ripple trim these clips. So I can cut off some content if I have too much in there, preparing my edit directly for within Premiere. So I've got that ripple trimming ability, the easy ability to move around my clips there in the timeline to switch around the order, and make sure that none of these clips actually fall out of sync or don't leave any gaps in the timeline. So those are some of the new features that are within Prelude. Last but not least, we'll just take a quick look here in Audition. And I have one cool thing also to show for After Effects that I forgot to mention. And new in Audition, we now have the ability, first of all, to export out Dolby Digital Sound. There's been some several improvements here to also tracks. So as you can see here in this multi-track that there are color-coded, I can take these tracks themselves and give each of them a customized color to easily identify, let's say, dialogue, SFX, music, ambient, and so forth. On top of that, in Premiere, just like in Audition, you have the ability to sort of, with your mouse or scroll wheel, increase the size of each of these tracks simultaneously. And sometimes you might want to increase the size of the majority of your tracks minus one. So I don't want to have that ambient track here, this one selected, affected by that scroll. So I'm going to go to my multi-track, okay? And during this option, I'm just going to select an option here for this track itself. To lock it out so that it's not affected by the actual scrolling itself. So I'm just going to choose this option called multi-track, minimize selected track. There, you'll notice that it's not affected by the scroll, making it a lot easier to deal with video clips. Now, also notice here, as I click on each of these different tracks, I have this thing on the side here called the track panner, and this was how for me to get surround sound. So you can see which speakers each of these sounds are coming out of. And I can adjust here with this little puck, it's actually quite a fun little game, to decide which speaker for it to come out of, right? So easily I can use this track panner, select each of these tracks, be able to switch my multi-track environment, and then last but not least, come up to my file menu, export this file as a multi-track mixdown entire session. Great workflow there with Audition in terms of being able to use clips and some of those subtle changes that Adobe's known to do to help with that audio process. Now, last but not least, I have a little thing here with After Effects. And how many of you guys love green screens who work with them? Huh, that was a trick question. You should not love green screens. So here's a green screen. It's not necessarily completely problematic, but they've brought in an addition to Keylight. And your ability here is, for those of you who know Keylight, it is the one effect to go for in terms of removing a green screen. But they've brought in a little effect here, off to the side, in addition to Keylight, which is a spill suppressor, and pretty much does almost an automatic job of keying out the green. So look what I can do in a couple steps. I'm going to take this effect and I'm going to throw it on my clip. And in the effect controls, I'm going to click this little eyedropper and choose a green to sample. Nothing different than the Keylight workflow, except there's this little effect down here called Key Cleaner, and it's already removed most of the green for me, nice and simple. On top of that, I have this effect called Advanced Spill Suppressor. You'll see that it's off right now because there is no effects icon next to it. But if I select this, you'll see that the majority of the green that was in her hair around the edges has been removed. I did that within just a couple seconds. So this green screen clear in terms of After Effects and being able to use that workflow, a lot easier. Bringing your attention to some of those features or those workflows between After Effects and Premiere, where you're now able to update that live text right inside of Premiere. You're also able to make your changes in terms of master clips. You have that workflow for masking and tracking, which is just phenomenal on all of your effects. So we can really see here the production line of the Creative Cloud is really coming together. So thank you.
All right. Awesome. Thank you, Nick. Yeah. Awesome. All right, guys, if we could switch to me, we're about to wrap up, but I still have some things to show you. If you could tell, as we switch to my screen, I do have two things to show you. We have, as I switch to my slides, and you'll see them in a second, this is really our first venture into hardware. All right, so this gets to be really fun, all right? And this is where I'm talking about mobile, okay? So we have new apps. We have Adobe Line. We have Adobe Sketch. We have Photoshop Mix, all right? And then we have Lightroom for mobile. So I have Lightroom on my iPad. I have Lightroom on my phone, right? And I have it on my desktop. Right, so I can take a picture of you guys, sync it to my Lightroom catalog, manipulate it if I want to on my iPad, go to my desktop, that's where it's gonna be. That's Lightroom everywhere is what that is. Awesome, check it out, I mean, it's awesome. And how much are these apps? Free? How are they paying my salary? I don't know, right? How do they do it? They're free for you guys as well. But the really exciting thing is that little icon down there at the bottom, if you could see Ink and Slide, all right? So this is fun. We now have a Creative Cloud connected pen. You'll see it here in my hand. This is Ink, and this is Slide. You guys can see right here, right? So this is great because we said, you know what? We wanted to create something that felt realistic and felt good to draw on, right? Because really, at the end of the day, it's all about the ideas you come up with. Hopefully, you can capture them wherever you are, right? And we wanted to create a pen, and again, I feel like we have the technology that is caught up with the ability to simulate great strokes, okay? So I'm gonna show you Ink, I'm gonna show you Slide, I can talk about the pressure sensitivity, connecting through Bluetooth, you know, the gyroscope in here, all of that stuff, the magic that you have integrated as well, and how they work with the apps. So that's what I'm going to do right now as we switch over, and I'm going to actually just open up Adobe Line. Okay, so I'm launching an Adobe Line. This allows me to create precision sketches. All right, so here I have my ink, as I call it. We take a look, we can jump in, and I don't know, this is just kind of cool. I'm gonna just show you guys this. If I tilt this up and I touch it, well, let's go back. Like, you customize it, and as I'm rolling over this color wheel, the colors change. So I can decide, hey, I want that red, just like that, and I've just customized it. That's kind of fun. But you get these little hints with the ink. Notice how it's actually, in the previous screen, it actually showed me the settings for how I hold it, so the palm preferences, okay, so it could do the correct offset for me holding it in my left hand. But let's just get right down to it, because I have this hard pencil selected, and as I just kind of pinch in a little bit, just as I even start to sort of draw, and I just have this blue selected, in fact, let's undo that, let's pick black, because I can just touch really light, and then I can also press harder, and you can see how that looks like a realistic pencil stroke, right? So I can jump in here, oh, I messed up, swipe to undo, jump in here, you know, and draw and sketch the way I want to sketch. And it starts to feel, again, really natural as I just jump in here, you know, start to sort of sketch out maybe a face, someone I saw at this point is all I'm doing, okay? So drawing with the integrity of that line because it feels and looks like a pencil, right? And I can jump in and I can start to change it. I can dive into any one of these if I want to. If I want to refine it, I could use this 0.5 millimeter, and I can even scale it down a little if I want to, right? Swiping back, and you know, I can start to get a little bit more technical in here if I want to, drawing over it and sketching appropriately. But I like this ability to jump in here, sketch out what I want or draw what I want. And again, I didn't say I was good, by the way. This is looking pretty bad. She's looking kind of mean. She's like, that's horrible. Jeez. Great thing is, guys, you want to change it? Sure, I could do the two-finger swipe to eliminate the last stroke or the last couple strokes, right? But I could hold down all three fingers, and I get that timeline. So I can take that back and take back all of those strokes. Because you know what? I'm realizing that, you know, I might like just the first, like there. It was better when there was less on the screen. As I don't know if I was helping it at all. Right? But let's just take a look at some of these other strokes. Just grabbing the brush, for instance, or marker. Okay, what do markers look like? You know what they look like. Jumping in here, start outline, add what I want. Okay, cool, cool, cool. Let's add some gold. Okay, there's some gold. Oh, what happens when I overlap? Just like in the real world, if I, you know, have yellow overlap blue, we get that green. So we're maintaining the integrity of these physical tools and drawing material and drawing instruments that we use, right? And we can always change that because you have that ability to customize. You want to turn off blending? You could turn off blending and you can see it's just going to be that solid gold color there as well. All right? So you draw what you want. I'm going to just jump out and actually let's just add a new drawing, shall we? And I want to show you something else. It's very exciting as I take a look and just start a new page. All right, wait for it, wait for it. Too fast for my own good. All right, so let's take a look at this. A couple more things. I'm going to go full screen here, right? Because this is really how I'd want to draw. And I could start sketching out things, right? Just like I would, maybe sort of creating a ground plane. I want to access any of those menus or anything from my Creative Cloud account. I just press this little button, okay? This little button on the device. You can see what happens, it gives me my Creative Cloud menu. Okay, so at this point, I can dive in and say, you know what, I didn't want the marker. Let's go back to a 2.5 millimeter pen. I can pick a different color. These are my different color themes. I could just take a blue. At this point, I'm back in, and again, I can start to sketch out what I want to sketch out in this scenario, right? Just keeping this simple. I'm trying to create maybe the Creative Cloud logo back there. All right, so not extremely sexy. Let's take it back. It's all right. We have access to Creative Cloud, my Creative Cloud stuff. In fact, if I take a look at that clipboard, here's my cloud clipboard. All right, this is really powerful, right? And we'll have this load up in a second, but I want to show you how you can get things into, I know you'll see it here in a second. Wait for it. Wait for it. Okay, so I did this awesome drawing up here, by the way. It's really awesome. Not really.
It's incredible.
And I just undo it before the screen refreshes. But what I can do is if I hold down this button and then I do a long press, the screen flashes, and you just saw it did a flash. My screen did a flash because it just took that image and sucked it up into the pen. And I can go to Nick's iPad, launch his sketch or line, and paste that illustration, and we can work together. Like, oh, here's a piece that I want to add. Let's try this. Bam, that's done, right? And again, I'm sorry this is not connecting. I'm not sure at this point. Actually, let me just do this real fast. Duh. And then get back into it. And all right, so hopefully that'll make it refresh. But as I click right here, I think our network's looking a little slow. But it basically pastes to my cloud clipboard. My Creative Cloud files, they're all in there as well. At any time, I can take an image that I put in Creative Cloud on my desktop, and it's available through my pen. As I click, oh, there it is. There's that logo I was working with. Or there's that logo that Nick was working on that I want to use he's a half a world away, pasting in my design on my iPad at a coffee shop, right? Definitely really impressive. So, yeah, that's how that works. So, okay, cool. Cool. Interesting. All right, so let's take this a step further, because I really want to get this to, so you can see this magic, because it is awesome. Great. What's that? Okay. So back in here. So we're pushing devices to their limits. Because I want to get into slide now, right? So we saw the power of what we could do there. I could do more with it. We have that precision. I'm using Line, Adobe Line. We'll see it here in a second. Wait for it. And I want to show you what you can do. As we take a look as well as my device hopefully pops up any second now. Because what, wait for it. I'll show you what Line can do. Just running. Wait for it, should come up. Do your magic. All right, that is fine. All right, so let's switch to the Elmo. I think this thing is still on. Awesome. All right, cool. Thank you. This is good. All right, so it might be a little washed out, but that's fine. And hopefully I'll just make the lines a little thicker and we'll be good. But I'm diving into Line in here again, and I'm going to use Slide at this point. Adobe Line, the app, is your precision drawing tool. If I use it with Slide, when I set Slide down, you see those lines, right? So at this point, if I want to have some nice basic lines, I can draw. Hold on one second. Since I was playing with palm rejection, let's make sure that is turned off as well. Okay, turning that off. There we go. Okay, so this works fine. Let me get back into it. So thanks for bearing with me. I'm going to set this down. You can see there's Slide, and whether I'm using my pen or my finger, as I draw, I have those perfect horizontal lines. So I can jump in here and start to draw with accuracy if I want to. You also see those bumpers start to develop. See those two little dots that come up? That allows me to just add an endpoint right there. I mean, honestly, I want to see every app do that. Okay, so again, that's what I'm doing, just drawing some simple lines. I can draw with thicker brushes so you can see it a little better, but I have that sort of control. You guys are like, okay, that's nice. Congratulations, you can draw straight lines. There's more to it than that. So let's take a look at it. Setting this back down, pressing this button, I can go from, and again, you don't see it on the screen, I can change those lines to a circle, to a square, to a triangle. In fact, let me double tap. There's my triangle, okay? So again, up here, and you guys can look at this afterwards, double tapping, there's my circle. And I'm also getting these various smart guides, okay, that I was talking about earlier. Oh, there's my square, double tap, bam, there it is. If I just wanted to draw part of a square, for instance, I could extend that out and just drawing with my finger, you could see I'm drawing, part of a square at that point. So I have full control over it. We can go beyond that as well, getting rid of those, going to these stamp packs. So again, basic shapes, I'm sorry you can't read these, but going into French curves, for instance, here's a French curve that you're going to see in a second. But all I need to do is draw. This is a French curve, right? Just so you can see the whole, just so you can see the whole thing. That's roughly what I'd do if I was, say, designing a car or furniture or even drawing a font, creating a font. You could start to use these curves, and I can click that button and start to cycle through different French curves, okay? So here's actually another one that I'm just going to scale up and start to see what that looks like. And I'm sorry you can't see it on the, that even is a little, there we go, that's a little better. But again, I have full control to make those curves and have as many as I want. if I go back in there to those stamp packs, I'm going to just read these to you. You know, Herman Miller, chairs, sofas, tables, trees, people, fashion figures, you know, animals, devices as well. So if I wanted to mock up a design, I can do that by jumping in here. Wait for it. Let's get rid of that last one. Putting this on.
Trying out turning the brightness down on the iPad.
It's like when I step away, it gets a little darker. But I just did a double tap, and there's an iPad. So you can see how I could start sketching out these various screens as well. But I didn't have to draw that. That's at my fingertips, okay? So this is very powerful what you can do. And really, at that point, I would create what I want. In fact, you can see this one. Nice illustration, just to prove. Hold on. Let's go into this one. Hold on. 1 second. All right, let's go into this one. Please don't go away. It just, he's like, no, you meant this one. All right?
No choice.
But at this point, I could go into any of these illustrations that I've made, and I could always scrub back and forward. So it's kind of fun to see how these various designs are made. And from here, I can also share through social media, through Behance. I need to move on to Sketch. Sketch is similar as well. Gives me that precision sketching ability. So you could start to, again, let me just go to one that's darker. But that's something that you could sketch out, as you can see here. At this point, if I want to share any of these projects, like this logo project that I was working on, as I select it, going right in here, we can get feedback. And at this point, I can share through Behance, and this will actually go appear out on Behance. What logo do you like best? All right, so I'm publishing this out right now. So if you're following me on Behance, you would get and be able to see these and comment on these. And the great thing is if you commented on this right now, I'd actually get a notification right in here and say, hey, no, it looks nice. So that immediate feedback is awesome. Behance community is awesome because people are nice there. They're like nice to you. I think it's just a lot of sensitive designers. Like, yeah, you're great. My stuff's great too. Like, yeah, and they give you feedback, but it's always very positive. It just makes me feel good. It makes me feel good, and then also makes me very depressed because there's so much cool stuff out there that I didn't make. So that's awesome. What it's all about. I can view it on Behance, and that's what you get. I can also do that through Line. Last app I want to talk about, Photoshop Mix, okay? And this will be tough to see, so I gather around after we break, which is actually 5 after 9 p.m., but this is the cool thing about Photoshop Mix, all right? I can start to mix things together. In fact, maybe we could do it with this. I don't know, we'll see. Let's see. Let's just do this, guys. Okay, check this out. This alone, look, again, you can't see this, but off to the side. You know, getting assets or any images from my iPad. So I was taking pictures earlier. I don't know if you guys saw, but I took this picture, and here's ink and slide on my desk, and I can start to composite maybe another image with it. So I'll just take this little guy, and I want to kind of put him right next to it. It's like, okay, we want to cut him out. We can cut him out just literally using my finger, and I can pinch and zoom in there, and I'm just using my finger. Wait for it, because I just selected his head, and I think as soon as I take away my hand, you'll be able to see this. But I'm just dragging with my finger, people. That's cool. Thanks, guys. I know, provided he was on green, right? How hard is it? You're like, oh, Paul, I'm not impressed. But the selection capability here is super impressive. And in anticipation of you thinking that, let's go to something like that's more complex. And I don't know if she's going to come in or not. Let's see how she does. But, okay, so this case, extracting her, how do we do that? Same cutout method, right? Hold on. Okay, cool. All right, just checking this out. All right, so at this point, I'm going to select her at this point. I'm selecting the wrong thing. Let's jump out. There we go. I had the background selected. So here we go. I have her selected. or that layer, sorry. I'm just going to remove the background, but I'm just dragging like over the background. If I want to get tighter in on her, say for her hair, actually freaking look at that. Feather edges. I could refine edges. Let's make sure that's on. There we go. Look. You guys got to come up here and see this. But this, to a large degree, does a better selection, in my opinion, over even Photoshop. But the powerful thing is I could cut her out like I'm doing now. Maybe it's good, maybe it isn't, you know, and maybe I want her like going to the light, which is just weird that that's happening right now. But overall, check this out. Like, sure, save to my camera roll, publish to Behance, and this one up here at the top, we'll just give it a second, but you know, push to Photoshop. So, and we don't have to switch to my machine. I have Photoshop open. It's gonna turn this into a PSD, send it to my desktop. The cutout job I did there is gonna be, what do you want? What do you want it to be if you tried to cut it out? What would you want that layer to be? A layer with a mask, right? With a layer mask. And that's exactly what it's gonna give you right over here once this is done. So it's non-destructive, you're good to go, you can continue to work on it there, okay? And the cool thing that's going on here, this will render, we'll give it a second. Another cool thing that is awesome about Photoshop Mix is I have this awesome selection capability, these other capabilities. Content-aware fill is on here, right? More intense processes that you just can't do on an iPad. Like if you wanted to do like an upright correction, that's kind of a processor intense thing. If you wanted to do a camera shake reduction, so you have a blurred image, that's something Photoshop has to do that heavy lifting. An iPad can't. It doesn't have the processing power. Plus, this is, you just don't have Photoshop running on the iPad. But what we do is we take this image, whatever process you want to do, we send it to Photoshop, guys, that's actually on a server, does the processing, sends it back to the iPad. And that's the sort of progress bar you get. Send to Photoshop, do the magic, send it back to the iPad. That's like awesome. So check out Photoshop Mix, because one, hey, it's free, right? Might not have a ton, if I'm being honest, there might not be a ton of things in there, but you start to see the potential if you have Photoshop running someplace else and you can tap into all that technology. So this, we're at the very, very, very beginning stages because this has only been out 2 days, right? So I have a lot, really high hopes for this, doing this processing, having Lightroom on here, doing my any color correction, and then when I go to my desktop, let me do my finalizing at the end of the day, and I'm doing a lot of this from so stored in Creative Cloud, and it'll pop up over there. But again, it's that simple. I'll just run this process, and I'll just let it do its thing, but overall, you know, cutting out, cropping, you have different looks from Lightroom that you could apply if you want to. And again, not that one, but I can apply those different looks. I can go into more. So if we wanted to do upright, this is shake reduction, content aware fill. I'm just gonna do, oh, look, guys, look, check it out. Oh man, I wish it came in clearer. Maybe it will. Look, it actually gave me three different options for this image, for sharpening it. It gave me three, on Photoshop I only have one option. It's the one I just did, right? And then you'd go from there. It looks great right here. Can I get an amen over here? Can you see
amen.
It? Amen.
That looks awesome.
All right. Sorry, the projector is not quite, you know, what we want, but very powerful. I'm done here. If we could switch back to this, to my desktop, and we'll wrap up here, and I'm sure there's some things that I forgot, which is why you should just follow us on Twitter as we dive into, you know, as we start to release more information. But that's Ink, Slide, Sketch, and Line, as well as Photoshop Mix. Again, Ink and Slide, which you see right here in this beautiful box, $199 available today. You can order it, which is awesome. Just 2 days old, Adobe's first venture into hardware, which is awesome. And again, we did our best within the time we had to cover all of those apps. Don't forget about Photography Plan is really the only thing that's new in terms of plans, if you will. Because we're just turning that into a permanent plan is where that's at now. So that's the big difference there. And that's what I talked about as well. So again, free stuff, everything that we covered, a lot of things that we did not cover, but we would be here for like 3 days. If